Welcome to Modern History of Europe. Lecture 6, The Great War. Part 2, Diplomacy and Propaganda. Now, the joint proclamation on 5 November 1915 of William II and Franz Josef that promised the Polish people an independent state with a hereditary and constitutional monarchy is one of the great forgotten events of the 20th century. As the Western Allies could now no longer stay behind the Germans and the Austrians too. And they had to equally promise that a state of Poland was to be founded after the war as well. All this still to the initial anger of Russia, for which Poland had always been a topic that was never to be discussed in the presence of a Russian official. Hence, Nicholas II had only made some fake promises that the state of Poland was to be reconsidered after the war in 1914, and nobody would likely have ever heard of it anymore had Russia won the war. Definite commitments to an independent Poland followed only after the February Revolution, by which time it was of course not very relevant anymore. And once the Allies had committed themselves to that promise of granting a state to the Poles, more promises to grant states to people who were without states so far, of which the Poles were one classical case, would inevitably follow, such as I mentioned already, claims to statehood of the Czechs, of the Croats, and of the Slovenians, and then demands from Russian nationalities, such as the Finns, the Estonians, the Lithuanians, and the Latvians, and then claims and promises of separate statehood to the Arabs in the Ottoman Empire would follow in turn. And, although the British were hardly overjoyed with those claims, for independence of the Arabs in Egypt as well, who were formerly merely living in a temporary British protectorate, so that the British had eventually to grant formal independence to Egypt in 1923 as well. And so too, demands for a state followed from that other classic case of a people without a state besides the Poles, namely the Jews, as we shall see in a moment. And it is hardly a coincidence that promises of statehood to the Poles, to the Czechs, to the Jews, and of a Yugoslavia to the Serbs were made in 1917, as the British and the French, after the slaughter at Verdun and the Somme, and the continuing carnage at Passchendaele, were becoming despondent of ever winning the war, and big declarations were needed to bolster domestic morale and convince people abroad to join the Allies. Promises of statehood were, incidentally, also made to that classic contemporary case of a nation lacking a country as well, namely to the Kurdish people, who are spread over Turkey, Iraq and Iran. They too were promised a separate state on Ottoman territory in 1920 by the British. Yet there was obviously no comparing the strength of the Kurdish lobby then and now with that of the Poles or of the Jews, so that all these promises of independence to the Kurds were soon enough forgotten again, as the Turkish state consolidated itself and was then formally recognized by the powers in 1923, any promises to the Kurds were shelved and have remained so until the present. In most of those former cases, the Arabs, the Kurds, and the Egyptians accepted. The idea of founding a new national home was above all conceived amongst the immigrant diaspora and amongst the immigrant diaspora of the United States in particular. The Czech state was first proclaimed in Philadelphia. Whereas with 4 million Poles in the USA, no political party there could ignore a Polish electorate who universally wanted their country restored. And preferably, it should be aggrandized with parts of Ukraine as well. And though of lesser significance, the some 200,000 Baltic and 300,000 Czech voters in the USA could not be ignored either. This immigrant vote was one reason why the nationality principle was so enthusiastically endorsed by American President Woodrow Wilson. Wilson is very popular amongst historians for the rather obvious reason that he was a history professor. And historians have often projected their supposed own virtues and their supposed own vices on Wilson. He was to them a noble man of lofty book wisdom and book virtues, who was, however, really a bit too good for this bad real world. And the historians have, as they have become fixed on his high-flowing rhetoric, too much ignored his other dimension as a common scheming party politician who was the whole time ogling what might came votes, as he was wont to, since his Democratic Party ruled by the slimmest of majorities. Wilson's focus on the nationality principle sprouted perhaps partly from his noble idealism and his naive Christian consciousness, as the historians often argue, and old Clemenceau indeed grumbled about Wilson's behavior that 10 commands sufficed for the good Lord, but Wilson needs 14. Yet it sprouted even more from that immigrant politics to which Wilson was simply pondering with his demand for making the nationality principle the basis for Entente diplomacy. And immigrant politics was the backbone of the so-called political machine of both the Democratic and the Republican Party. The American Polish community had, after all, been the main financier of the Polish national movement for half a century. And thus the demand for national homelands was initiated by the American Poles, and they were followed by the American politicians. But it was not invented by the American politicians, as the American historians commonly naively assume. This formation of Poland, then, was a brilliant and far-reaching step of the Germans, who were trying to foment both the nationalist and the progressive discontent amongst the Entente powers. For far from being a reactionary bastion, Germany had every claim to be a progressive country. The Socialistische Partei Deutschlands was the world's biggest and most senior social democratic party, after all, and had completely rallied behind the empire's cause. For such a fomenting of progressive and nationalist discontent, there were also plenty of opportunities in the Entente countries. Deeply reactionary Tsarist Russia, after all, contained some 140 nationalities and had swallowed entire countries, from Finland to the Emirate of Kokand. And though the Entente powers, the Russian embarrassment notwithstanding, still bravely proclaimed themselves to be democratic powers, this of course ignored the colonial empires of Britain and France and Italy as well, who had swallowed even more countries than Tsarist Russia. And any future prospects for democracy there were even more distant than they were in Russia. The Germans indeed tried to rally the Indian nationalists to their cause, which worried the British enough to put the entire old nationalist leadership behind bars. One reason for the emergence of the one nationalist leader who supported the British cause during the war and campaigned for Indians to enlist in the British Empire's army, Mohandas Gandhi. The Ottomans called for an uprising against Italian rule in Libya. And all this so successfully that by the end of the war, the Italians had virtually lost control of the entire country, save Tripoli and Tobruk, to the insurgents who were led by the Sanusi Islamic Brotherhood. The Germans, however, did not call for any anti-colonial uprising in Africa, as any revolt against colonialism might well turn into a revolt against German colonialism as well. And the colonial First World War in Africa was hence a peculiar kind of white man's war, where the mainly, and for the Germans virtually completely, African troops had to slaughter one another for the pleasure of being, instead of under the German, now under the French, Belgian or British yoke, or indeed under that of the South African racists. However, the British and the Boers both proclaimed they were a vast improvement over those ghastly Huns. Yet the Huns still had some success with encouraging the nationalist cause. Thus, they did encourage with much success the Flemish national movement by declaring that the University of Gand, Ghent, the only one in Flanders, was henceforth to be exclusively Flemish speaking. Some activists of the Flemish movement pleaded for a separate Flemish state that would join Germany, in which initiative they were, of course, supported by some Germans. However, the German authorities were wavering on whether Belgium was to remain a separate state after their German victory in the war, or was to be annexed by Germany. And they were therefore also reluctant to encourage anti-Belgium movements. And the Germans too began the long process of Belgium's administrative separation between a Dutch and a French-speaking administration by establishing a separate French-speaking administration in Namur. The Germans also tried, but without much success, to encourage desertion amongst the Islamic, Senegalese, or Moroccan and Algerian soldiers of the French by reminding them of their ultimate allegiance to Islam and hence to the Ottoman Caliph. And critically and very successfully, they both encouraged and armed the Irish nationalist movement Sinn Féin and the Russian revolutionaries, as we shall see later on. The Eastern Rebellion in Dublin in 1916 had been organized and been armed by the Germans. However, all such German attempts to rally support by supporting national liberation and progressive movements, and thus to rally international sympathy in the USA as well, in the colonial world or in such non-belligerent countries with large German communities as Argentina and Brazil were undermined by two things. First, by the typically German heavy-handed occupation policies they initially used in Poland and far more visibly so in Belgium, as in Belgium there were plenty of Englishmen and Americans to witness German outrages, and some of them too happened immediately across the border with the neutral Netherlands. And in particular, there was the shooting of some 3,400 people in Belgium by German troops in August 1914, as they were advancing. The Germans were panicked by rumors of armed men in civilian clothes, franc-tireurs, who were shooting on their soldiers from ambushes. That indeed became a common practice later on. But in 1914, partisans fighting an occupying army in uniform, who were dressed in civilian clothes, was considered something some Balkan country might resort to. But such a civilized country as Belgium would never do so. And the German allegations of franc-tireur attacks were indeed never proven. It seems they were mainly caused by the Germans shooting at each other. And then there were such misdeeds too, as the mistaken burning of the university library of Louvain, or the intentional burning of the Belgian town of Dinant, or the mistaken shelling of the Cathedral of Reims, on which it caught on fire. All that was thoroughly exploited by Entente propaganda, and those 1914 outrages completely ruined the German image for the entire rest of the war. Although for the rest of the war, the German occupation of Belgium was civilized enough. Newspapers were obviously censored, and mild prison sentences of only a few days were imposed if people protested against the German occupation. And the worst inveterate protesters, such as the great Walloon historian Henri Pirenne, who had publicly denounced the introduction of Flemish on his university in Ghent, were detained in a prisoners' camp in Germany, where they mainly bored themselves, but otherwise were very well treated. The factories in Belgium had to sell materials to the Germans at fixed prices. The Germans also required fixed deliveries of coal, and some 170,000 Belgians were persuaded, though rarely forced, to work as laborers in the German industry. But if the Belgian population was not wildly enthusiastic about the German occupation, there was little real resistance. Rather, as most Belgian industry had to close down because of an Allied blockade that put some 650,000 people in Belgium out of work, for most Belgians the war was a dull and forced holiday. The Germans permitted the distribution of medical, food and humanitarian aid by the state government being on the other side of the IJssel River, Belgium's other government, the management of the almighty multinational Société Générale. And as the food situation in German-occupied territories deteriorated in 1917, together with the deterioration in Germany itself, the Germans too allowed the importation of food by the Belgium Relief Fund, for which a massive campaign for aid to the starving population throughout, comparable to, say, Band-Aid later on, was put up in the USA and organized by future President Herbert Hoover, so that in the winter of 1917, the population of occupied Flanders still had more and better to eat than had Germany's, where there was no such American relief. The Belgian horrors the population of the Entente countries was spiced on for the entire war, in which the Germans as much ate babies as had brothels exclusively meant by nuns, all proved to be inventions of the Allied propaganda after the war. Indeed, in many respects, World War I was, after all, mayhem during its beginning, and with the major exception of Ottoman behavior towards the Armenians, fought relatively humanely, aside from and away from the horrors of the trenches, that is. Thus, for instance, Russian or French and British prisoners of war, and there were more than a million of them by 1918, were treated quite well in Germany. They had only to do relatively light work in agriculture, and officers did not have to work at all, and they all got as much to eat as the rest of the German population, though admittedly that meant they ate very little. Only a few hundred prisoners died in camps in World War I, a major contrast with that other Holocaust, that of Russian prisoners of war, that was committed by the Germans in the Second World War. Much as too, and also completely unlike in the Second World War, the German regime in Poland was mild and correct, and the Germans did their best to supply Poland with medicine and food. In fact, after the initial chaos and devastation of the Russian retreat and the German advance, the German occupation regime in Poland was likely far lighter, far more liberal, and far more forthcoming towards Poles than Tsarism had ever been. And merely a few dozen people were sentenced to mild prison sentences for resisting German occupation, including, incidentally, Josef Pilsudski in 1918. Indeed, the civilian casualties in World War I were in all of Europe, but not in the African or Middle Eastern theaters of the war, relatively light, unlike the hecatombs of civilians in World War II, when civilian casualties commonly exceeded military ones by a factor 4 or 5. Thus, on some 2,000 military casualties in the Netherlands come almost 200,000 civilian casualties. Yet both parties already resorted to bombing and shelling civilian targets in the Great War in aerial bombardments, first by Zeppelins and then by Kota heavy bombers on England and by the Allies on German frontier towns such as Freiburg. There were also a few coastal raids on British cities by German battle cruisers and, in a few instances, long-distance artillery of the Germans shelled Paris. There were no moral objections to strategic bombing in World War I, therefore. But aerial bombing in World War I was not even in its infancy, as rather a baby then. And so only a few hundred were killed in strategic bombing compared to the millions who were killed in World War II. Second, and even more importantly, the German military, with hesitant support of the government, ruined their own course of persuading public opinion of the goodwill of Germany and of its love of peace by pinning themselves down on attaining the maximum goals during this war. The German aim in the war was to be the construction of the so-called Mitteleuropa, Central Europe, a term invented by geographer Friedrich Naumann. It was to be an economic unification of Belgium, the Netherlands, France, and the territories of the Habsburg and German Empire. But rather than some early form of the European Union, Mitteleuropa in reality meant an indefinite German domination over the whole of Middle Europe, including the annexation of Luxembourg, Antwerp, and Liège, and if not all-out annexation, then at least a factual German protectorate over the rest of Belgium. Then the northern French industrial areas were to be annexed too, and the Germans would exercise a factual control over whom ruled in France and in the Netherlands, while Russia would at least lose to Ukraine and the Baltic states that were to become German protectorates. The Ottoman Empire, in turn, wanted the control over Baku and over its oil, and preferably over Georgia as well. Austria wanted to annex Serbia, and after Romania's declaration of war on the Central Powers in 1916, it wanted to annex most of Romania as well. And it wanted to construct a reunited Kingdom of Poland to cover Austrian Galicia and Russian Congress Poland, that was to be made into a new Habsburg crown. The European continent was to come under a form of German hegemony, in brief, that might perhaps have been quite mild, just like the European Union, but that was at any rate to be merely the springboard to a new and future war for world hegemony with the USA and with the British Empire, whence the Germans more vaguely talked about annexing the Belgian Congo with its mineral riches and the Portuguese colonies in Africa as well, so as to obtain naval bases for controlling the trade of the Indian Ocean. Yet, for such fast aims to be attained, would have required a complete German victory in the war. Thus, as German historian Gerhard Ritter has argued, in Bismarck's time, following the example of Frederick the Great, of course, the conduct of war by soldiers was subordinated to the attainment of limited diplomatic aims by the statesmen, and soldiers were subordinated to statesmen. Victories on the battlefield were in that period nice, but were seen as far less important than victories on the negotiating table. However, after the July crisis, the soldiers effectively took over German policy making, and German diplomacy became a mere handmaiden to the military's aim of attaining complete victory. Diplomacy was only to shore up discontent amongst the opponents, or it was to further recruitment in occupied countries, and it was, on the brink of it, not very successful in either of that. And any call for curtailing such unrealistic demands of the German soldiers so as to allow for some moderate peace settlement, was immediately shouted down by both the soldiers and by the German parliament that until 1917 was completely overawed by the military brass as unpatriotic. Whereas the statesmen, the Kaiser and Chancellor Theobald von Bethmann-Hollweg, were already completely overawed by Supreme Commander Friedrich Falkenhayn, whom they barely dared contradict and were altogether subservient to his successor, Paul von Hindenburg. For Hindenburg, who was, however, really only the spokesman of Erich Ludendorff, who to all practical purposes was Germany's dictator in 1917 and 1918, diplomacy was merely to facilitate victories on the battlefield. Yet the realistic prospects for a victory in the war, sufficient to demand Mitteleuropa even after the German victories over Russia in 1915, were not good. For with lightly bringing in Britain into the war, so as to implement the Schlieffen Plan, the German army had terminated prospects for a quick and decisive victory. As not merely Falkenhayn, but Bethmann-Hollweg too, in the beginning of 1916, perfectly well realized. The emperor by then was already completely out of the picture and hardly participated in military or diplomatic decision making any longer, except by saying yes to everything. The only thing the Germans could now realistically still ask or hope for was some compromise or some status quo ante peace. Germany might in such a settlement recover her colonies in Africa that were occupied by the French, the Belgians and the British in 1916, and it would keep her fleet. But Germany would have to withdraw from Belgium and from the occupied territories in France and Russia and would perhaps even help to restore them. Serbia, however, would then permit Austrian policemen in her territory so as to investigate the murder on Franz Ferdinand. However, practically everybody had completely forgotten what this war was all about by the 4th of August 1914. But Bethmann understood by a compromise peace not the status quo of 1914, but the status quo of 1916. Germany would retain at least the iron fields of Lorraine and military control over Belgium. She would receive additional colonies and Poland would become an independent German puppet. Bethmann came a bit more closer to compromise than anyone else in that he was prepared to pay a small price for Germany's gain. A fragment of Upper Alsatia was to go to France and South Tyrol was to go to Italy. But essentially his position and that of possible Entente compromisers as well were identical. Neither of them would accept the compromise terms proposed by the other side without military defeat, and in that case compromise was unnecessary. And the decisive victory needed to achieve the supposed compromise would be followed by a dictator peace. For if all the human suffering of 1914 and 1915 had been to no avail, merely issuing in a compromise peace, then that would certainly mean the toppling of the ruling conservative coalition and then rule by the socialists. And that was a prospect from Beekman-Holweg or Falkenhayn or Ludendorff dreaded even more than they were afraid of defeat. Only by mid-1917 had the Reichstag become sufficiently unruly for the social democratic delegates who were in the majority there to insist on the empire offering some realistic and some more modest peace terms to the Entente. Yet even at that time, the terms on which Germany would negotiate were still, as the German government said, a frontier that would protect Germany and Poland strategically against Russia. More colonies, strategic and economic changes of the Franco-German frontier, and special guarantees for the safety of Germany in Belgium. And even those terms were likely only the beginning of what Germany would demand if the situation changed in her favor. Yet before early 1917, anyone who even dared to doubt the eventual total victory of the Fatherland was immediately shouted down as a defeatist and as a betrayer of our courageous boys in the trenches and might risk imprisonment for it. And he was shouted down in Parliament as much as on the street. For in Germany, in France, in Britain, and by extension in its dominions as well, but far less so in Austria, Italy and Russia, the war, with the initial outburst of patriotism in which anyone had rallied to the cause, had entailed a call to what the French called the Union Sacrée, and what in Germany was called the Burgfrieden as well. Everyone was now French or British or German first, and only then was he a nobleman or an agricultural laborer. While the hatchet of the class struggle was to be buried for the cause of the war until the final victory was attained. Though admittedly, the government would have to create a home fit for heroes to live in, as Lloyd George classically foisted after the war. And everywhere the governments had thus to promise more generous pensions, and they had to guarantee a fixed gainful employ for the returning heroes from the war as well. Indeed, and significantly with the exception of the USA, which was not long enough at war for it to have any major impact on the home front, and where this idea is essentially post-World War II, the idea that it is the task of the government to provide full employment to its citizens dates from the First World War. Before the war, employment was seen as a responsibility for employers in which the state would not meddle. Thereafter, however, it was deemed no longer acceptable that men who had risked their life for the fatherland would end up in the garbage bin of unemployment. Yet they still would after the war, and this explains much of Europe's subsequent history. In not only proclaiming, but initially indeed achieving such a Union Sacrée or such a Burgfrieden, it obviously helped that the French could say they had been attacked by the Germans, and that the sacred ground of France was now defiled by La Boche. Indeed, the hundreds of thousands of miserable refugees from northern France who crowded in refugee camps in Free France remained throughout the war the main argument for the French to reject any compromise settlement with the Germans on which the Germans would gain. The Germans would have to pay for all their misdeeds. The German government, in turn, had lied that Russian troops had already moved into Germany before Germany's declaration of war on Russia. So that in the popular perception, peaceful Germany had to be defended against warmongering Russian militarists. And like in France, hundreds of thousands had fled East Prussia for the Cossacks as well, with all the dreadful things the Cossack was going to do to the maidens. Britain finally had come to rescue poor little defenseless Belgium. Yet such kind of arguments of merely acting in self-defense availed Russia and even more so Austria, until it was attacked by Italy, that is, and Italy far less, as they had, after all clearly had been the aggressors in this war. Yet the only way governments could persuade the population to bury the class struggle for the time being and settle for their everyday miseries was to promise them total victory. Such miseries as the 2-hour longer workday and the lower wages that were everywhere demanded from the workers, so that wages fell, for example, with 35% in Germany, while prices tripled. And yet everybody knew full well that the Krupps, the Steeners or the Armstrongs were making record profits, as were other big concerns. And the terraces on mundane Leicester Square, on the Champs-Élysées or on Berlin's Alexanderplatz, although the tone was there by 1917 more somber and more austere than in the former places, were still packed with elegantly dressed party people. Most people suffered in that war, yet clearly some people prospered. Thus, the only way the war could be sold to the population was by promising total victory, and that applied to all combatants. It included Tsarist Russia as well, that would have annexed most of Austria and Turkey had its army won the war. And in 1916, it actually came very close to that. And as the war dragged on, demands became ever more intransigent on both the German, but as we saw, not on the Austrian side, who would have happily settled for some status quo ante peace by 1916, and on the Entente's side. And as both the propaganda and the public rhetoric of the statesmen had constantly stressed all atrocities that had been committed by the German militaries, Germany was by 1917 for the Entente no longer a normal state with which one could normally negotiate, as rather some kind of existential threat to the whole of humanity. And by 1916, the Entente, therefore, began to stress the aim of the war should be the total annihilation of German militarism. Lloyd George thus replied to a German note offering peace terms in 1917 with a quotation from Abraham Lincoln, quote, "We accepted this war for an object, and a worthy object, and the war will end only when that object is attained." This object, undefined by Lloyd George, was presumably the destruction of German militarism. That meant the toppling of both the German government and the Kaiser, and the implementation of such far-reaching reforms in Germany's system of government as might be demanded by the Allies, nothing less. Yet Germany would, of course, never consent to completely overhaul its system of government in any compromise peace settlement. Yet up to 1917, the Entente preferred to keep somewhat subdued on what its precise war aims were. A few of these aims were plain simple and predictable, such as that the British wanted the German colonies in South and Southwest Africa, modern Namibia, Tanzania, and parts of Cameroon and Togo. All of that at Germany's costs. Although the biggest imperialist gains of this war were at the Ottoman Empire's expense. The British wanted control over Iraq and Palestine, that is modern Israel and Jordania, and the French over Syria, that is modern Syria and Lebanon. The First World War was not only mainly fought for the control of the Middle East, but in carving the Ottoman Empire up into barely sustainable little countries, it created another and a far worse Balkan, exactly as the statesmen had feared before the war already would happen when the Ottoman Empire fell apart. The British wanted the German High Sea Fleet on the bottom of the sea as well. The crews of the German fleet incidentally chose to scuttle their fleet themselves in January 1919 as their ships were interned by the British at their naval base at Scapa Flow. That suited the British just fine, as they would have had to defy the High Sea Fleet amongst the other victorious powers otherwise. Other powers that might well turn enemies later on, as was indeed the case with Italy. The French wanted Alsatia and Lorraine, and they wanted more territory in Africa and Syria. The Italians wanted Trieste, South Tyrol, and Dalmatia, and they had an endless provisional list of more territory they might want in addition, particularly at the Ottoman Empire's cost. They were sure they would never obtain all of it, but they asked for all of it anyway, and finally did succeed in obtaining the Ottoman Dodecanesos Islands off the coast of Asia Minor, of their, as it were, territorial demands plus lists. And Belgium wanted huge swathes of northern Germany and Zeeuws-Vlaanderen from the Netherlands besides, though nobody in Belgium had any idea how they were to obtain that, as the Netherlands had after all been neutral in the war. However, they planned on offering the Netherlands some of all their new territory in northern Germany as compensation. However, climbing down from those demands, which would well have fitted diplomacy in the 17th or 15th century, they finally settled on the tiny territory of Malmedy and Eupen in Europe. And Eupen has remained an odd German-speaking enclave in Belgium to the present day. And on obtaining the fake German protectorates of Rwanda and Burundi in Africa too. However, the Allies had agreed not to sign a separate peace in 1914, and some of Russia's demands, and particularly Russia's secret demands, and very much in particular their old demands for the complete control over the Bosporus and for the erection of the Orthodox cross over the Hagia Sophia, not only contravened the British policy of the entire past century, but conflicted with the traditional claim of the British Empire it was religiously neutral. Were the Russians really to erect the cross on the Hagia Sophia, this might have caused an uprising of the British Empire's 100 million Muslims. As Wilson's envoy, Colonel House, rightly summed the true situation of 1916 up, if the Allies win, it means the domination of Russia over the continent of Europe. If Germany wins, it means unspeakable tyranny of militarism for generations to come. The British, however, hoped that time might perhaps provide some solution to all that embarrassing Russian territorial greed. So they preferred to stay somewhat vague on what the precise demands of the Entente were. To the great irritation of House, who heard nothing but subterfuges from them. So as to keep those Russian demands, or the Entente promises to both Italy and Serbia, they were to obtain Dalmatia that could never be mutually fulfilled, covered up. The Bolshevists eventually found the minutes of the Anglo-French-Russian negotiations and published those negotiations, however, in 1918. So as to prove their argument, the World War was an imperialistic war that was fought for territory and for profits of transnational companies rather than to make the world safe for democracy and against the German threat against humanity, as they had been saying all along. That caused a shock at the time. The population had always been taught the war was not fought for base territorial gain, as rather for high worthy causes. It was fought for liberty, for democracy, and to safeguard the world from militarism henceforth. Now it appeared to have been fought for base territorial gain anyhow, and the population had never been told anything about this. All that played a major role in American President Woodrow Wilson's later plea to abolish secret diplomacy. For secret diplomacy was to him the real cause of World War I. Instead, according to him, diplomacy should now be conducted in the open, in full sight of democratic opinion. Yet most diplomats think, and they probably rightly think, that this is quite infeasible. For party politics thrives by noisy confrontation, has short spans of attention, and needs success fast, while diplomacy is all about cautiously seeking compromises, and diplomacy always works slowly. The French and British governments thus needed to convince their population this was not some old-fashioned imperialistic war fought to satisfy the greed for more colonial territory. Though, of course, if the British annexed something, that was a blessing to the local population and a burden to them, as the British were convinced. The natives should be thankful for such a selfless British gesture as the occupation of their lands. And no one to a Frenchman can possibly perceive a greater joy in life than being turned into a Frenchman in the admittedly very distant future. And that was what the French always said they wanted to do when they annexed territory. However, as said, those bad Russians might demand territory as well. And Russia was loathed by both British reactionaries as the old colonial rival and by socialists as the reactionary bogey. Rather than a war for precise territorial aims, therefore, such as the typical 19th century war, the Great War was sold to the public as a holy crusade against the diabolic forces of German militarism or against accursed German imperialism. An imperialism from which the selfless British liberators had now come to free the populations of, say, Namibia or of Tanzania. Or again, there was the even worse Turkish misrule and Turkish disregard for human rights. The British came to bring order, state of law, and in due course rule by a democratic national government, as they told the population of Baghdad as the British army moved in there in 1918. Some listeners may discern a pattern here. As to the French, Les Boches had to be evicted from the sacred soil of France, and then they had to be punished. And for its sacrifices, France deserved some territorial gains. Though no Western ally, save Italy of course, gave initially much thought to Austria, on which indeed they had only declared war to please Russia, and only in late 1917, when the British and the French had to rush troops to Italy to prop up the tottering Italian front, did they directly fight with Austrians. And it is probably true too that only that timely French intervention saved Italy from total defeat by Austria in 1917. Only in 1917, then, as the war appeared to be going from bad to worse and the home front became increasingly restless as well, so that they needed any propaganda slogan they might possibly seize on, did the Entente powers begin to harp on Austria's oppression of the nationalities. At that time, propaganda presented a closed front, and the entire British and French historians' guild was enlisted by it as well, and the historians were actually proud to be enlisted. This great war was to them fought to defend British and French civilization and the British and the French Empire, the greatest agencies for good in human history, after all, from the ghastly Huns, as the British called the Germans, though the term was actually first used by William II during the Boxer War for his intended behavior of the German detachment sent there. Thus the historians argued. And as especially Lloyd George, who always used a vaguely leftist terminology when he was addressing working classes audiences, that he of course immediately shed again in his own cabinet, consisting of bankers, industrialists and noblemen, like to stress. This was a war fought against German territorial greed and against German imperialism. A German imperialism that had caused the war as well. For if the Germans wanted to annex territory, that was for ruthless exploitation by German industry. Whereas if the British and French did so, they came to bring material progress. And they were, of course, both merely materially losing on their imperialism that had nothing to do with capitalists either. As British historians, commonly employed by the De Beers or the Cecil Rhodes Foundation, were and still are always eager to argue. German colonialists and firms were ruthless capitalist and imperialist exploiters, the British, however, selfless philanthropists. Even more so, the South African whites, of course, who were stressing that the Germans were murderous racists as well, witnessing their mass murder on the Herero people of southwestern Africa that was thoroughly milked out by South African propaganda. Nobody surely had a greater selfless love for black Africans than South African whites and South African Boers in particular. And such present historians as Max Hastings are indeed still convinced this war was fought for a great sacred cause. Britain fought against ruthless German militarism and defended that peace and that right of people to national self-determination of which, say, British India or the South African native territories were such shining realization. And such professed patriotic historians would surely still rate anybody who was not quite convinced this great war was a patriotic duty imposed on the British people to halt German militarism, such as Bertrand Russell was, who ended up in prison for opposing the war, as betrayers of the fatherland. Betrayers of the fatherland who fully deserve to be put behind bars. And am I the only one to think that the habitual denigration of undeniably England's greatest thinker of the 20th century nowadays has a lot to do with that supposed betrayal of the fatherland during the Great War, although it has probably to do too with his completely inexcusable later opposition to more of such noble causes, just like the Great War, like nuclear armaments and America's war in Vietnam, opposition that is, of course, all communist fellow traveling to our patriotic historians as well. A particularly pathetic case of an opponent of the war who was afterwards cajoled into shaming himself for it by such patriots like Hastings is the father of modern world history, Arnold Toynbee. Just like Bertrand Russell, he was not sure whether getting killed for the British Empire and for King George V was such a noble and becoming thing to do, as anybody of his own very upper-class milieu assured him it was, so that he managed to dodge serving in the trenches by a fake medical attest his health was too bad to allow him to. And then he felt ashamed he had done so, and with that betrayed his country and his comrades for the rest of his life. Although Toynbee, ironically, more than anybody else, was always convinced this whole war had been utterly absurd, and constantly said so too. Thus, Toynbee was ashamed of not having died for no reason whatsoever, or for having been so clever as to not having been beguiled by propaganda. Yet though the majority of British intellectuals were thus convinced, on penalty of prison sentences to be sure, they were fighting a barbaric enemy, and the French intellectuals even more so, at the same time, a whole slew of German professors protested against all that. For they, of course, also, almost to the last man, supported the fatherland as well. And surely the German historians were amongst the most ardent patriots, all supporting the heroes on the front line, fighting for the defense of Germany against the Cossack horde and English plutocracy. They did so, to repeat, almost to the last man, though that last man, the only one who stubbornly refused to publicly support the war, just happened to be Albert Einstein, who too broke with his old friend Fritz Haber when Fritz Haber began to patriotically develop that poison gas that was now to bring the fatherland its victory. And sure, by 1920, two other German physicists already tried to prove that the theory of relativity was unpatriotic and not Aryan. In a grand public declaration then, denouncing the Entente's propaganda, all the rest, the entire German professorate, thus adduced that to term the world's bastion of learning, of science and of arts, a country of brutal militarists was an insult to reason. Whereas for Britain, that controlled a quarter of the globe, to accuse Germany of imperialism and of territorial greed strained belief. Now it may be conceded to Max Hastings and all the other present patriots that most British, including critically the ruling classes themselves too, who were slaughtered during the war, and certainly Prime Minister Herbert Asquith, who lost his only son in the war, believed they were indeed fighting evil German militarism and imperialism. And yet, objectively, the whole thing still reminds one of the apocryphal dialogue between a Zimbabwe Shona and a colonial officer. Quote, the officer says, "Away with Hitler, or for that matter the Kaiser, away with him." "What's so bad about Hitler?" asked the African. "Hitler wants to conquer other countries." "What's so bad about that?" "You see," says the colonial official, "all people should rule themselves. Italy belongs to Italians, so Italians should rule Italy. Germany belongs to Germans, so Germans should rule Germany, and so on." As he was finished, the clever native noted he had carefully avoided mentioning the British. End quote. Yet though in early 1916, the German High Command and Falkenhayn effectively made a peace settlement, if not impossible, then unlikely, by their fast and unrealistic ambitions of attaining continental hegemony that the Entente powers would never concede to them, they also despaired, typically German, whether such expectations were realizable or feasible. Victory was very distant in 1916, despite all the temporary triumphs in Poland. But Russia would eventually recuperate, argued Falkenhayn in a critical memorandum he addressed to the Kaiser in December 1915. And further dispersing troops into the fastness of Russia was not likely to bring victory any time soon. And Falkenhayn and the Germans indeed acted very cautiously. They bailed that the Tsar's regime might collapse soon, and it seems to me they wisely stayed out of the territory of Russia proper during the war and did not venture beyond Poland and western Ukraine, rather than that they marched, say, on Minsk or Smolensk, as they might equally well have done. Nicholas II could not use the cry, therefore, that the fatherland was in danger, that his grand-grandfather, Alexander I, had so effectively used in the days of Napoleon. Despite all the claims they were defending the fatherland, the propaganda made, as I shall argue later on in more detail, to most Russians, the Great War was and remains a war fought on France's behalf on alien territory. It never became a patriotic war, like the war against Napoleon, let alone a great patriotic war, like the Second World War. The main enemy the Germans had was neither Russia nor France, let alone Italy, but it were the British, argued von Falkenhayn in his memorandum. And Britain was to Falkenhayn not that small island off the European coast that our patriotic British historians always like to perceive, to them an endearing small country presenting no threat to anyone, but still disliked by nasty foreigners for no discernible reason whatsoever, except perhaps its unique devotion to the cause of liberty, but rather to Falkenhayn, Britain was that empire on which the sun never set. That empire that, as I said before, was not only very threatening, but that had always behaved highly aggressively as well, and that the Germans could not only not beat, as it was after all over the world, but that vastly outclassed Germany in its mineral and in its trading wealth and in its financial reserves. That very nearly equaled Germany in industrial capacity, and when the dominions, and not even to speak about India, were counted in, outclassed it in manpower as well. And the British indeed ended the war with nearly 2 million men who were recruited in the empire. The Schlieffen Plan, in other words, had involved Germany in a war it could never win, not only as the British could prop up the other belligerents forever, but as the Entente disposed of the reserves of the entire world, while with the Allied naval blockade, Germany's reserves had effectively shrunk to those of Germany and of its few occupied territories that Germany, as we saw, for humanitarian reasons, not even exploited very thoroughly, as half of Belgium's industry, as said, stood still. Perhaps Germany might still force Britain to the negotiating table, however, if it inflicted severe damage on what Falkenhayn called its sword on the mainland, France, enough to bring France to its knees. For the traditional policy of the British had always been to pay somebody else to fight its wars for them, and traditionally that had in fact been Falkenhayn's own Prussia. And the British were traditionally unwilling to face heavy losses themselves too. If France surrendered, then Britain would probably also give up the fight. To do so, as Falkenhayn put it in a sinister formulation that had, in my view, rightly come to stand for World War I generalship in general, Germany would have to bleed the French army to death, as he said it, by forcing it to defend one place and then smashing it by heavy artillery while committing as few men as possible to the battle. The first modern Materialschlacht, where war materials substitute for soldiers. For this Materialschlacht, Falkenhayn had picked a little town on the Meuse that the French would never surrender, both since the town and the ring of modern fortresses around it was the hinge of their western front, and because it was the cradle of France itself. As the name Francia was first mentioned in the treaty that bore the name of this little town of 845, Verdun. In February then, the Germans assembled the largest number of guns so far ever assembled to attack Verdun on as small a front as possible. And to conceal this massive build-up and shield it from the French recon aircraft, the air above was for the first time covered by the Air Force as well, the fabled Flying Circus Squadron of Baron von Richthofen. Indeed, aside from many other nasty military innovations, such as the first use of flamethrowers and mustard gas, the Battle of Verdun also witnessed the birth of the modern concept of air power and air supremacy. The local French commander, Edgar Driot, was very nervous about that clear German build-up in Verdun, however much the Germans tried to hide it, but he could still hear it from the frontline trenches. For a World War I offensive entailed the stockpiling of hundreds of thousands of shells that had to be brought there by hundreds of trains and then fetched by thousands and thousands of horses and thousands of lorries. That makes an amount of noise that is impossible to suppress. However, all of Drio's warnings were ignored by headquarters, either because they assumed the Germans would simply continue to attack in Russia and would allow them quietly to prepare the great attack on the Somme that they were planning in July and that was to coincide with Russian and Italian attacks, and in which the new British all-volunteer army for the first time would play the main role, or more likely because he was a socialist member of parliament, and socialists the French headquarters did not cherish at all, to put it mildly. For going back to the Dreyfus affair, the direct roots of Vichy and indeed of the Algerian crisis can be found in World War I. Thank you.